Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be thankful. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 15. Well, welcome once again to Wednesday Night Bible Study. My name is Carl Luther, and this is KDL Ministries. And I just love this direction from Paul. He addresses God's chosen people by calling us the elect of God, holy and beloved. You can make that a devotional study by that scripture all by itself. Did you know that you're the elect of God and that He says that you are holy and beloved? Through Jesus, we've been grafted into the vine of Israel and are every bit the chosen people of God as the flesh and blood Jews are. That in itself is amazing. And like the Jews who God said are His holy possession, we too are holy and beloved by God. And because of this, Paul says that we are to put on bowels of mercy. So let's talk about the bowels that Paul's referring to. Think about a time when you've been so sickened by a horrible event in your life. A time when the pit of your stomach was in raging turmoil. When your most inner parts of your being felt like it was being ripped out. Well, that's the bowels that Paul's referring to. And he says, from the deepest part of your inner soul, from your bowels, let mercy pour out. He said that kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, come from the depths of your soul. He also said to forgive one another just as Christ has forgiven you. Now, take on that and chew on that. Has there ever been anyone in your life who's hurt you so bad that you felt like dying? Well, no one's ever been hurt like Jesus was. He was physically beaten. He was betrayed with a kiss by one who He loved and ate bread with. And then ultimately, He was forsaken by God Himself as He died on the cross. He was forsaken by God so that we can be accepted by God. Folks, that's a love that no one can even comprehend. But Jesus loved us so much, that's exactly what He was willing to do in order to establish an everlasting covenant that we could have with the Creator of the universe. And Paul says to forgive each other just like Christ has forgiven us. Now go look in the mirror. But Paul caps it all off by saying, above all, meaning the most important thing to do is put on charity, which is a bond of perfection. Charity here is a Greek word agape. And if you've ever studied all the Greek levels of love, then you know that agape love is the highest form of love. It's God's love. It's a type of love that's synonymous with perfection. And Paul even says that this kind of love is the bond or the glue of perfection. And when we operate in all of these things, then Paul says that the peace of God, or the shalom of God, will rule in our hearts and that we'll live with one another as what? As one body. What a scripture to meditate on. But it's this peace that I want to tie into our story with David. And if you remember, Abner was strengthened his hold on the house of Saul so much so that he even slept with Saul's concubine. Remember what that insinuated? But then when Ishbosheth called him out on it, Abner got so angry that he swore that he would hand the kingdom of Israel over to David. Let's review that part of the story. Let's look at 2 Samuel chapter 3, verses 8 through 10. Then Abner was very wroth for the words of Ishbosheth and said, "Am I a dog's head that belongs to Judah? Today I show kindness this day unto the house of Saul thy father, to his brethren, and to his friends, and have not delivered thee into the hands of David, that thou chargest me this day with a fault concerning this woman? So God do to Abner and more also, except as the Lord has sworn to David, even so I do to him, to transfer the kingdom from the house of Saul, and to set up the throne of David over Israel and over Judah, from Dan even to Beersheba." And if you remember, I questioned Abner's motives here. Would he really make a covenant and promote David as king over not only the one tribe of Judah, but over all of Israel? Or was he just spying out David's kingdom to see if there was any weakness that he could exploit and attack? After all, we read over and over how Abner was strengthening his hold on the house of Saul, right? He was as guilty as anyone for all the persecution that David endured all of his time of exile. And the scriptures don't bear out any repentance in Abner's life that would indicate any change, except for what we're about to read next. I want you to take note of how many times the word peace is used in these next few verses. Let's continue reading. 2 Samuel chapter 3, verses 20 through 23. So Abner and 20 men with him came to David at Hebron, and David made a feast for Abner and the men who were with him. Then Abner said to David, I will arise and go and gather all Israel to my lord the king, that they may make a covenant with you, and that you may reign over all of your heart desires. So David sent Abner away, and he went in peace. At that moment, the servants of David and Joab came from a raid and brought much spoil with them. But Abner was not with David in Hebron, for he had sent him away, and he had gone in peace. Then Joab and all the troops that were with him had come. They told Joab, saying, Abner the son of Ner came to the king, and he sent him away, and he has gone in peace. Three times the scripture emphasizes the word peace, that Abner departed in peace. And you know what? Not every time in every person's life mentioned in the Bible is it going to tell us that someone had a change of heart. And I believe that's what we might be able to conclude here in the life of Abner. And why? Because of this peace that he went away in. Now, I don't know the extent of his relationship with God at this point, but I do see the relationship and trust that David had, who of all people had more cause to question Abner's motives, but didn't. Instead, David threw a big party in honor of Abner and his men, and I trust David's judgment in this matter. If Abner did have any hidden motives or deception in his heart, I believe David was led enough by the Spirit of God to have sniffed that out. And the scripture says that David sent Abner away in peace. Once again, Israel was about to be unified as one body, as bowels of mercy, long-suffering forgiveness was on full display by David. But Joab, David's commander of the army, had other thoughts. He was still under the impression that Abner was a sworn enemy of David. He wasn't there to have witnessed the change in the heart of Abner. Let's continue, picking up in verse 22. At that moment, the servants of David and Joab came from a raid and brought much spoil with them. But Abner was not with David in Hebron, for he had sent him away, and he had gone in peace. When Joab and all the troops that were with him had come, they told Joab, saying, Abner the son of Ner came to the king, and he sent him away, and he has gone in peace. Then Joab came to the king and said, What have you done? Look, Abner came to you. Why is it that you sent him away, and he has already gone? Surely you realize that Abner the son of Ner came to deceive you, to know you're going out and you're coming in, and know all that you are doing. And that's Joab's rightful suspicions. He was out raiding and doing the king's bidding. He wasn't there to witness the words of Abner, so you can't blame him for his initial thoughts. Let's continue, picking up verse 26. And when Joab had gone from David's presence, he sent messengers after Abner, who brought him back from the well of Seirah. But David did not know it. Now when Abner had returned to Hebron, Joab took him aside in the gate to speak with him privately, and there he stabbed him in the stomach so that he died for the blood of Asahel, his brother. Now look and see who the evil person was. But one might say that Joab was in the right and that he was justified by God's law. He was what was called the avenger of blood. Remember that law? No? Well, let's review it. In the law of Moses, if someone committed a murder, then the victim's next of kin had the right to avenge his death. But there were some quid pro quos. There were some specific rules that had to be followed. Let's see if you can pick up on them. Let's look at Numbers chapter 35, verses 10 through 15. Speak to the children of Israel and say to them, When you cross the Jordan into the land of Canaan, then you shall appoint cities to be cities of refuge for you, that the manslayer who kills any person accidentally may flee there. They shall be cities of refuge for you from the avenger, that the manslayer may not die until he stands before the congregation in judgment. And of the cities of which you give, you shall have six cities of refuge. You shall appoint three cities on this side of the Jordan, and three cities you shall appoint in the land of Canaan, which will be cities of refuge. These six cities shall be for refuge for the children of Israel, for the stranger, and for the sojourner among them, that anyone who kills a person accidentally may flee there. So the law of Moses called for these six cities of refuge for any man who accidentally kills someone, so that he could flee from the victim's next of kin, who is called the Blood Avenger. You didn't see that word, Blood Avenger? Well, let's continue. Let's pick it up, verse 16. Numbers chapter 35, verse 16. But if the manslayer strikes him with an iron implement so that he dies, he is a murderer. The murderer shall surely be put to death. And if he strikes him with a stone in the hand by which he could die, and he does die, he is a murderer. The murderer shall surely be put to death. Or if he strikes him with a wooden hand weapon by which one could die, and he does die, he is a murderer. The murderer shall be put to death. The avenger of blood himself shall put the murderer to death when he meets him. He shall put him to death. If he pushes him out of hatred, or while lying in wait, hurls something at him so that he dies, or in enmity, he strikes him with his hand so that he dies, the one who struck him shall surely be put to death. He is a murderer. The avenger of blood shall put the murderer to death when he meets him. So there you have it. The avenger of blood. And Job could have easily fallen into this category of the blood avenger. But could he really? Do you remember how Abner killed Joab's brother Asahel? Asahel was in hot pursuit of Abner with intent on killing him. And what did Abner do? Well, they warned Asahel to break off his pursuit. And when he didn't, did Abner intentionally kill Asahel? Well, let's reread what happened. Let's look at 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 22 through 23. So Abner said again to Asahel, "Turn aside from following me. Why should I strike you to the ground? How then could I face your brother Joab?" However, he refused to turn aside. Therefore, Abner struck him in the stomach with the blunt end of the spear, so that the spear came out of his back, and he fell down there, and he died on the spot. So it was that as many came to the place where Asahel fell down and died, they stood still. Abner struck him with the blunt end of the spear, not the business end of it. Abner was trying to stop him and was actually acting in self-defense. So knowing this, Abner was not considered a murderer, and Joab had no right as acting as a blood avenger. So Joab was acting under his own interpretation of justice as he stabbed Abner in the stomach after deceiving him at the gate of Hebron. Which brings up another damning role of Joab. We spoke about these cities of refuge, another one of those pictures of Jesus. He is my refuge and my strength. Or how does the psalm say it? Let's look at Psalms chapter 91, verses 2 through 4. I will save the Lord. He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him will I trust. Surely he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. So Jesus is our refuge. He's our strong tower, and the righteous will run to him. And in the law of Moses, God gave these cities as cities of refuge for an innocent manslayer to run to for protection from the avenger of blood until his case could be heard by the court. Well, guess what Hebron was where Joab murdered Abner? It was one of those six cities of refuge. So even if Abner was found out to be a murderer, he was on sacred ground until he was proven guilty and was not supposed to have been touched by the blood avenger until such point. So now it's Joab who is guilty of murder. And David will never forget this evil deed by Joab. Let's continue to hear David's reaction to what Joab did to Abner. Let's pick up in verse 28. Afterward, when David heard it, he said, "My kingdom and I are guiltless before the Lord forever of the blood of Abner, the son of Ner. Let it rest on the head of Joab and all his father's house, and let there never fail to be in the house of Joab one who has a discharge or is a leper, who leans on a staff or falls by the sword, or who lacks bread." Now, why David didn't just have Joab executed is beyond my pay grade. Instead, David delivered Joab up to the curse of the law, which may have been even a more harsher punishment than immediate death. A man who had an issue was considered unclean and was barred from any Jewish religious sacrifices or feasts. And such an unclean person was cast off from Israel and God until he was purified and made whole. The same was for a leper or for one who was crippled. These were conditions that God called unclean, and they barred an individual from corporate worship and communion with God. And David cursed Joab with these things and said that even his offspring would die by the sword and remain hungry for bread as well. Continuing, picking up in verse 31. Then David said to Joab and all the people who were with him, "Tear your clothes, gird yourself with sackcloth, and mourn for Abner." And King David followed the coffin. So they buried Abner in Hebron, and the king lifted up his voice and wept at the grave of Abner, and all the people wept. And the king sang a lament over Abner and said, "Should Abner die as a fool dies? Your hands were not bound, nor your feet put into fetters. As a man falls before wicked men, so you fell." Then all the people wept over him again. His hands were not bound, nor his feet put in fetters simply means Abner was not led away to death like a guilty criminal being chained up. Instead, he died by the hand of a wicked man. Let's finish out our chapter, picking up verse 37. For all the people and all Israel understood that day that it had not been the king's intent to kill Abner, the son of Ner. Then the king said to his servants, "Do you not know that a prince and a great man has fallen this day in Israel? And I am weak today, though anointed king, and these men, the sons of Zeruiah," meaning Joab and his other brother, "are too harsh for me. The Lord shall repay the evildoer according to his wickedness." So David left justice into the hands of God. And in Solomon's reign, Joab will be dealt with. But as we read this story, let's not forget or overlook the lessons that point towards Jesus. David showed bowels of mercy towards Abner, his enemy. The forgiveness that he showed through a covenant with Abner erased years of injustice shown towards David. And because of the charity that David walked in, Israel would now once again be bound in perfectness as one body. All 12 tribes under one king, King David. Join me next week as we see the death of Ishbosheth and the coronation of David as king over all of Israel. Until then, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, rule in your heart. Good night.
My peace I give unto you. It's a peace that the world cannot give. It's a peace that the world cannot My peace I give unto you.